Intel has just released a new line of processors, but I almost let it pass unnoticed. However, I do feel like giving the blue team a chance from time to time, and so the Intel Core i9-11900K was the perfect reason to do it. Today I'm going to discuss the new CPU, but also its generation overall, namely the Rocket Lake. In addition, I would like to talk about the Z590 platform, since it marks Intel's transition towards PCI Express 4.0, and this brings along some interesting stuff. For this, I tested not one, but two motherboards with this kind of chipset, ROG Maximus 13 Hero and ROG Maximus 13 Apex. The former is an all-round high-end choice which highlights the best this platform has to offer. The latter is dedicated to overclocking and it features some capabilities especially fitted for this niche. Let's take them one by one and see if Intel is still what it used to be, or not, or worse. So stay with me for a few minutes and let's see what's what. Intel Core i9-11900K uses an innovative and groundbreaking technology in its manufacturing, the brand new 14 nanometers architecture. In this respect, let's welcome Intel in 2015. Ah! I mean, come on guys, 14 nanometers is like a dinosaur with arthritis. It's 2021 and I can't really hide my disappointment despite my initial hopes. At first I was like, well, it's an Intel Core i9-11900K. It speaks high FPS, so I'll ignore those 40 nanometers. Some overheat and a couple of mediocre benchmarks later, I finally wrapped my head around the CPU I was testing. I exhaled calmly and let go of my irritation once I realized I shouldn't feel bad or cringe at Intel's Rocket Lake series, especially concerning the CPU. You see, this might be the last time Intel used this 40 nanometer architecture, but the jokes are just priceless, not going to lie. 14 nanometers is outdated considering the fact that across these 5 years, AMD had managed to stay in the fight with its new Ryzen generation. However, this new generation of Intel CPUs can somehow be considered something brand new. But it's not because of the processors themselves, but because of their respective motherboards. Even in its mediocrity, Rocket Lake is important, and I want to talk about this. Before that, I will not even try to understand Intel's strategy of pumping out new processors. I don't give a rat that Rocket Lake, to some degree, is a 14 nanometer port of an initial 10 nanometer design, etc, etc. It's a disappointing release and there's no excuse for that. And I'm telling you this not as an AMD fanboy or things like that, but as an individual who's in love with technology, but he's disappointed with a company he used to respect. For me, the wallet dictates the final word, not how blue or red my PC is. First, let's focus on the plus side. Why is Rocket Lake noteworthy? Because it offers support for up to 20 PCI Express 4.0 lanes, which will be of great help for ultra-fast NVMe SSDs. This transition from 16 PCI Express 3.0 lanes to the aforementioned 20 PCI Express 4.0 will ensure you can install and use NVIDIA's and AMD's newer GPUs alongside a 4th generation NVMe SSD, all of these perfectly synchronizing with the processor for maximum performance. In order to manufacture this new generation, Intel made use of something similar to Ryzen's Infinity Fabric technology, thus resulting in one-to-one outturn via RAM and CPU for a performance boost. And that's not all. Intel's support for superfast memory is even more interesting and more promising than Ryzen's capabilities, as you shall see. Overall, Intel claims Rocket Lake is 19% more powerful than Comet Lake in some scenarios, alongside hardware solution for meltdown issue, PCI Express 4 support and faster memory speed, which is a nice conclusion to a dynasty of 40 nanometers processors that lasted for 6 years. And it's this last part that intrigues me the most. In the case of our new friend here, i9-11900K, we are presented with a downgrade, meaning this one has fewer cores than its i9-10900K sibling. Not only are they fewer, but they are also lazier, and this doesn't really sound reassuring. Even the specs indicate a lower Intel smart cache, although this downside is directly related to the number of threads. If it sounds complicated, just have a second look at the table. The Rocket Lake generation packs some upgrades as well, the most obvious one being the support for newer technologies such as Thunderbolt 4 and USB 4. It's not that much, but it does sound more promising than what the previous generations offer. However, considering the pace at which Intel comes up with new batches of processors and chipsets, it won't take long for Rocket Lake to become outdated for a handful of reasons. Let's not be hasty nonetheless. Patience is a virtue, the same way Intel had incorporated the same 40 nanometer architecture for the past 6 years. Without further ado, let's see how good Intel Core i9-11900K can be in benchmarks, during gameplay and during everyday tasks as well. For the sake of comparison, I will summon some rivals, namely Ryzen 9 5900X and Ryzen 9 5950X. As a side note, i9-11900K and Ryzen 5900X are almost identical in specifications, so I will lean towards comparing their prices. Besides that, there will be also a flagship confrontation with 5950X, naturally. Have a look at this table as well. It details the platform I built in order to test Intel's flagship. Most of it keeps the same good old components, such as the case and the 1000W PSU. The star here is the ROG motherboard, and not just a ROG motherboard, it's that high-end exclusive ROG motherboard. As of the graphics card, we're using an Asus NVIDIA GeForce RTX 3080. More or less the king of chipsets. The most interesting pick for today's test rig is actually the RAM kit, clocked at 4800MHz CL19, because I want to see if the high frequency really matters. Behold, at my left side lie the Intel Core i9-11900K benchmark scores next to its competitors' results. I would advise you not to judge a book by its cover, so don't take the numbers for granted. I'm still surprised by the Intel Core i9-11900K single-core results, although almost no one cares about single-core anymore. Here, Intel's rocket managed to stick close to its rivals, AMD's most powerful processors. In fact, it even managed to outperform them in Geekbench 4. But again, these are just plain numbers. This time, let's get to the most important and fun part, gaming. Let's see what Intel's newest flagship is made of. Combined with NVIDIA RTX 3080, i9-11900K achieved some promising results. These tests were run at Full HD resolution. Normally, I despise Full HD, but that was a necessary evil if we wish to see how well the processor performs, because the higher the resolution, the lower the processor's contribution. Go on, study another table. The in-game results were a bit more uplifting, turning Core i9-11900K into a potentially valuable asset. But it's Intel, so not everything is plain perfection. Because of that, I must address two extremely controversial topics regarding the Rocket Lake series: power consumption and temperatures. Core i9-11900K is advertised as having a TDP of only 125 watts, and that's a big fat lie. The moment you turn on any of the three turbo boost functions, the processor starts eating 200 watts of your home's electric bill, which in turn will affect the temperatures. As if an RTX 3080 wasn't ruthless enough, the PSU has to endure this additional TDP as well. Even worse, Intel did not care to include in the box at least something, anything which might resemble a CPU cooler. Sorry man, that's up to you. And this is where things get nasty. Many people might be something like, oh cool, this processor eats only 125 watts. It means I can buy the cheapest cooler on the market and everything's going to be just fine. The same people might have a surprise once this animal starts chomping away 200 watts of your PSU. Sorry dude, you might need to let go of that Hyper 212 Evo and search for a Be Quiet Dark Rook Pro 4, Noctua NHD14/15, or something even better, such as a 280 AIO and other fancy stuff. My testing rig includes the aforementioned Be Quiet Dark Rook Pro 4, more than enough to hold off the processor's heatwave, but alas, the motherboard is simply not built for this, but rather for water cooling. As seen, I had no other option, and the results were worrying. Over 90 degrees Celsius achieved by the hottest core during benchmarks. Things went better in game, with a maximum value of 80 degrees Celsius while playing really demanding titles. On the other hand, Intel Core i9-11900K revolves around 29-30 degrees Celsius in idle mode and holds an average of 65-70 degrees Celsius in most games. Here's the trick. I had to, and I managed to understand the process of RAM optimization. Thanks to AMD's Ryzen 7 5800X, I am now aware of the fact that things like frequency, latency, and their impact upon performance should not be overlooked. In this respect, AMD is not that flexible, since we are talking about a max clock of 4000 MHz when keeping an outturn of 1-to-1 between Infinity Fabric and this base 2000 MHz frequency. Intel's Core i9-11900K, on the other hand, is not that rigid, allowing for more liberty when juggling with memory kits. Personally, I used ADATA XPG D50 Extreme 16 GB clocked at 4800 MHz with a voltage of 1.5 volts. This means very high frequency with decent latencies with a voltage I wouldn't recommend for daily use, and is not capable of doing that by simply selecting the DOCP preset. You have to manually set up the profile in BIOS. Compared to it, Intel makes everything easy peasy. BIOS boot, select XMP, and that's it. But if you're the average user, there's no point in doing all this mumbo jumbo, so just get a 3600 MHz CL16 memory kit, and that's it. But enough of this. Let's do a quick recap and see whether Intel's newest flagship is worth the money or not. Rocket Lake stands as Intel's 11th gen of processors. Its new technology is based on an older one, the manufacturer choosing to regress from 10 nanometers to 40 nanometers, hopefully for the last time. So what does this mean? It means Core i9-11900K has fewer cores than 10900K, its price is similar to AMD's 5900X, and its performance settles between 5600X and 5950X, depending on software/game. The test rig consisted of two motherboards, ROG Maximus 13 Apex and ROG Maximus 13 Hero. Yes, I might have a soft spot for ROG's motherboards, but they are versatile and powerful. On top of that, ROG Maximus 13 Hero was made for a Rocket Lake-based system. Case in point, it offers a solid PCB, 1200 socket, 4 RAM slots, a great variety of inputs and outputs, PCI Express 4.0 port, a must-have for nowadays graphic cards, and some nice accessories as well, like a bracket designed for securing the graphics card. The design is the company's trademark. Some sleek black tones with RGB lighting all over its surface, flanked by some huge, handsome radiators. If you're looking for a high-budget motherboard to complete your Core i9-11900K build, this model is for you. ROG Maximus 13 Apex is something else. It's the madman's motherboard, suitable for those who are obsessed with Cinebench exact scores. But this also means you will have to make do with only 2 RAM slots and a single SODIMM in which you can insert an SSD hub designed for NVMe, similarly to what Crosshair 8 has. Maximus 13 Apex is my recommendation to everyone looking for power and high frequencies, especially since it has its own royal reputation. This is the exact model a guy used to overclock this exact CPU to 7 GB. At the end of the day, Intel Core i9-11900K is sadly a big letdown. It has the price of an AMD Ryzen 9 5900X, less performance overall, decent in-game results, but it has a greater TDP, which means it requires stronger power supply and more aggressive cooling. These downsides make it too expensive and too power-hungry for me to invest in such a processor. Well, just like any other product, this processor has its own niche and its own dedicated community, the Intel fans which modify their rigs every new release and wish to enjoy the PCI Express 4.0 and the Z590 compatibility. It can be an exciting challenge for overclocking enthusiasts. It can be a nice choice for Intel software aficionados, and it simply is the choice for people used to Intel's products. You, me, us might not be tempted into getting one of these rockets, but there will certainly be interested folks. Personally, I would rather go for the Ryzen 9 5900X. Similar price, but better performance, less TDP, less overheating, all of this based on a renowned and well-crafted chipset, in contrast to Z590's yet unexplored territories and potential flaws. What's Intel Core i9-11900K to computer enthusiasts? Well, it's the last 40-nanometer CPU of its kind. It might not be a collector's cup of tea, but it comes as a nice ending to an interesting chapter in Intel's history book. It makes way for the new and innovative. A hope for redeeming and becoming again AMD's most dangerous rival. With that being said, will the Intel fans throw rocks at us? Don't get angry. Instead, ponder upon this for a bit. The tests are right here, and they speak for themselves. Would you rather go for Intel's newest flagship rather than a Ryzen 9 5900X? Why and why not? Is Intel finally managing to catch up with the competition? I rest my case, and I invite you to speak your minds in the comment section. Thank you, and don't forget to subscribe.